Therefore, it is not limited only to the applications filed for registration. It goes beyond that. That's why I was trying to tell you that the powers given under the various officers appointed under the Maharashtra Public Trust Act, if you read carefully, will give you an idea that every function of the trust, public trust or religious trust, is controlled, is supervised by the Office of the Charity Commission. Once such application is filed, the inquiry, as I was mentioning, has to be taken in accordance with the Rule 7 of the Bombay Public Trust Act. Now, Rule 7, really speaking, is the rule that provides for the procedure of the inquiries. And that rule lays down that for the purpose of inquiry, the procedure of trial of suits as envisaged in the Provincial Small Causes Court Act or Presidency Small Causes Court Act, as may be applicable to a particular region, will have to be followed. Therefore, the inquiry that will be undertaken by the Charity Commissioner or Deputy or Assistant Charity Commissioner will be of very detailed manner, which includes the procedure of taking evidence. And upon appreciation of evidence and facts on record, the Assistant or Deputy Charity Commissioner is expected to render his decision under Section 90. This is also an instrument to arrest frivolous attempts to claim a property which is otherwise of the public trust as a private property. Therefore, powers under Section 90 are also available to the Assistant and Deputy Charity Commissioner for its invocation suo motu. Therefore, if the Assistant or Deputy Charity Commissioner thinks that a particular property is not a public trust or is public trust property, they can also suo motu invoke its powers under Section 19 and conduct appropriate inquiry. But at the same time, there are various judgments that have rendered a very valid law point or that have laid down a very relevant or substantial legal proposition that while conducting Section 19 inquiry, the powers of the Assistant Charity Commissioner or Deputy Charity Commissioner are not such where they can adjudicate any title dispute, because the title disputes are to be adjudicated by the civil courts. So that power cannot be exercised by the Assistant Charity Commissioner or the Deputy Charity Commissioner. Now, there are various case laws, and some of which may be relevant for you to note down, which say that these title disputes cannot be gone into by the Assistant Charity Commissioner or Deputy Charity Commissioner under Section 90. Now, Bombay High Court, in the full bench judgment of K.K. Zamdar versus Rodabai, 1974 Bombay Law Reports 198, as also in Ram Narayana versus State of Maharashtra 2005 Volume 2 MHLJ 95, have laid down this proposition, and it's been considered and consistent in its application. And there are others also, such as Ram Narayan Lal Sahu versus State of Maharashtra 2005 3 All MR, Jagat Narayan Singh versus Chitre versus Swarup Singh Education Society 1980. And there are many, if you try and do research, there is a line of judgments which prevents the charity or the Assistant Charity Commissioners from going into any title disputes. So, apart from that, if you are going to investigate or rather inquire into any matters which is covered by Section 19, as per Rule 7A, the public notice has to be issued if and only if you are going to decide whether a particular property is of a public trust or not. And therefore, that notice, really speaking, is a notice to all the public at large to file its objection when the Assistant or Deputy Charity Commissioner is going to decide upon the issue of the property, which is on the issue whether a property is a public trust property or not. And therefore, it's a detailed inquiry that will be undertaken or that is undertaken by the Assistant Charity Commissioner under Section 90. For finding out the existence of the public trust, the Assistant or the Deputy Charity Commissioner must undertake the inquiry to ascertain origin, object and nature of the trust based on the documents produced, and to ascertain whether the applicant has the right to execute the deed of settlement or has a locus to find such application under 18 for registration. That's a very important aspect inquiry of which is required to be undertaken by the assistant or deputy charity commissioner. Now, as under by virtue of section 7, the provisions of CPC to an extent are made applicable wherever it's applicable. Therefore, if an application under section 19 is dismissed for default, let us say, then by invoking the powers under order 9, you can restore that application. And also, if there is an application which is filed and the trustee or the applicant dies, then such application will not be rendered ineffective by way of an abatement. Either such application will not abate, because really speaking, this application is filed for the purposes of the interest of the trust, or for the purpose of finding out or seeking a finding which eventually serves the interest of the trust. Therefore, even if the applicant is dead, the proceedings do not come to an end. They clearly go on, and the assistant charity commissioner or deputy charity commissioner is bound with the obligation to reach or make that application reach its logical conclusion. Whether a particular trust is a public trust as per sections 213 is to be ascertained from whether a beneficial interest is vested in uncertain or fluctuating body of individuals and the trust is of a permanent character. That also one of the parameter to be understood, to be kept in mind, to ascertain whether a particular trust is a public trust. It is an obligation of the assistant or deputy charity commissioner to give a finding on every aspect on which the inquiry has been undertaken. So it has to give a finding on whether a particular property is a public trust, or whether a public whether a trust exists, or whether a particular trust is a public trust or not. Now, if one says that provisions of the CPC are applicable, so why can't a settlement take place under in the applications under section 19? The answer is no. The settlement can never take place. Even in fact, there was a recent circular of the Maharashtra state government whereby all the charity commissioners have been instructed to inform the relevant deputy and joint charity assistant charity commissioner that wherever any application which was earlier filed has been withdrawn for whatever reasons, the government has informed or government has directed all the assistant or deputy charity commissioners to renumber all those applications and investigate and rather conduct inquiries in all those applications and pass the orders. Therefore, no such application which is filed in section 19 can be compromised on account of the deal or on account of the agreement that the parties or contesting parties in section 19 have come arrived at. Therefore, once you file an application under section 19, assuming one files, then that application, really speaking, becomes the job of the assistant charity commissioner or deputy charity commissioner, who will thereafter take all the steps so as to understand, investigate, and give a final order or judicially adjudicate that application based on the facts mentioned in the application, or rather the facts that may surface after filing of the application based on the inquiry and taking upon appreciating the evidence that may be filed, that may be adduced by the parties during the course of the inquiry. Therefore, there is no settlement as such in any of the applications that are filed in section 19, or for that matter, any application that is filed before the charity commissioner. Because really speaking, by filing an application before the charity commissioner, you are just trying to bring charity commissioner's attention to a particular fact and nothing else. And then it becomes the charity commissioner's own jurisdiction in which no other person can intervene. The charity commissioner under section 19 or deputy or assistant charity commissioner section 19 is the inspector as well as the adjudicator. It's a very different sort of powers that are invested or rather vested in assistant or deputy charity commissioner. He inspects also and he adjudicates also. So it's sort of a dual function vested in the same authority. And the primary duty of the assistant and deputy charity commissioner under section 19 is to act in the interest of the trust. After you complete the inquiry under section 19, charity commissioner, assistant or deputy charity commissioner has to give its finding, and those findings will be recorded if there is no appeal filed. Those findings will be recorded by way of entries in the book that I was mentioning in section 17. So all these procedures will be followed, will end in the findings being rendered, findings being given by the assistant charity commissioner, deputy charity commissioner, and thereafter all these findings will be recorded in the register section mentioned in section 17. And such entries once made after exhausting your remedy of appeal will be final and conclusive. So only way, if you want to challenge these entries upon once made, the only remedy available is to go before the High Court under section under Article 226 or 227, depending on the situation. Now, more importantly, if the finding as regards issues covered by section 19 is given by court, let us consider an example that in a suit of declaration of a title filed in a proper civil court, a court as an arbiter gives a finding that a particular property is a public trust property. Then such finding, question is whether such finding can operate as res judicata, whether does it close the powers of the assistant or deputy charity commissioner invested in it under section 19. The answer is no. Such findings of the trial court or rather the civil court on the issues that are squarely covered by section 19 can never act as res judicata. These are the findings that can be given only and only by the assistant or deputy charity commissioner. And they can't be given by this. But naturally, the issues regarding the declaration of the title and issues regarding the declaration as regards the adverse possession, let us say, then such issues that can be rendered and only civil court having authority to render such findings are applicable to all the authorities, be it charity commissioner, be it land revenue court authorities, they are applicable everywhere. They are uniformly applicable. And therefore, these findings will naturally act as res judicata, but not other way around. Not the findings given on the issues that are covered under section 19 can operate as, if given by the civil court, can operate as res judicata. Now, that brings me to a very important proceedings or aspect of proceedings, which is generally initiated under section 22. That's called change. That's the proceedings that are initiated under section 22 are known as change reports. Now, what are change reports? Now, section 22 says that if there is any change in any of the entry that is mentioned under section 17, such change will have to be brought to the attention of the trust, attention of the assistant charity commissioner or deputy charity commissioner, as the case may be, within a period of 90 days. And then the assistant or deputy charity commissioner has the obligation to A, ascertain whether the change has occurred, B, even if the change has occurred, whether such change is legal and valid, and only upon conducting the inquiries to find out the answers to these issues, the assistant or deputy charity commissioner will give finality to the change. And thereafter, the change can be recorded in section 17 register. The questions that are posed before the High Court, Bombay High Court, in various judgments was whether a change upon reporting, can it be said that such change takes effect immediately upon report, or do we have to wait for the order of the charity commissioner to proclaim that such change has occurred? The answer of the Bombay High Court is in the negative, in the sense that the High Court says the moment you go to hire the charity commissioner or the assistant or deputy charity commissioner, depending on the situation, the moment you go with your change report and you tell the charity commissioner that, look, there is a change, the change is immediately can be said to have taken. Only the finality, only the conclusion to such particular change will be given upon passing of the order by the assistant or deputy charity commissioner. But the change has taken place, the moment you go to the charity commissioner and say that, look, the change has taken place. For example, if a trustee tenders resignation, he tenders resignation, and thereafter the resignation is accepted also. But there is a different procedure, or rather a procedure is encapsulated or enlisted or envisaged in the trust deed as to how to accept a particular resignation. Some trusts have the procedure where resignation upon tendering will be effective. Some trusts have the procedure where the resignation upon tendering will not be effective unless there is the meeting of all trustees and all trustees, after deliberating on the issue as to why the resignation is being tendered, accept such resignation, and only then the resignation, sometimes or as per the procedure laid down in the instrument of trust, becomes active. Now, there are various cases, or other innumerable cases, where the trustees gives or tenders resignation, and whether that particular resignation is in accordance with the procedure laid down in that particular instrument of trust or not becomes the question of litigation that will be decided, or that is decided in Section 22 proceedings. But that does not mean that the change that is reported under Section 22 on account of the resignation has not taken place just because there is no decision rendered by the assistant or deputy charity commissioner in the change report. And that does not mean that the Section 22 application, the trustees will have to wait for its disposal to ascertain, or rather to act on the change that according to them has already taken place. Now, what happens? Because change reports are very meticulous, or rather very detailed proceedings, and they are generally dealt with like a suit. And therefore, there is a procedure of filing objection, there is a procedure of filing cross objections, there is a procedure of filing affidavits, rejoinders. Thereafter comes the issues, though the issues are only two. But there is the requirement under Rule 7 to lead evidence. And once the evidence has to be led, then there is a cross-examination, then there are a number of witnesses, there comes the proving of documents, then there comes the marking of document. So these procedures under Section 22 are very lengthy. So they generally take any time between 3 to 4 years, or sometimes 5 years also. Therefore, the question is, if the trustee, let us assume an example where the trustee tenders a resignation in the year, let's say 2010, and his change report only is decided in 2015, whereby the assistant or deputy charity commissioner says that no, that registration was absolutely invalid, not in accordance with the procedure, and therefore not good in law. Therefore, the trustee cannot be said to have given resignation or tendered registration, and he is entitled to come back if he wants. On the contrary, if the trust deed says that the trustee is given, or the term of the trustee is only of, let's say, 7 years, or let's say only 4 years, or let's say only 3 years, then what happens? The Bombay High Court says that whatever is the time that is lost between the or in the change report will have to be compensated, will have to be given back to such trustees. So upon the date on which the order is passed, whereby a resignation, for example, is held to be invalid, and the trustee, if he is willing to come back, then that period that is lost in litigation will have to be given to him to act as a trustee. So that's just a one sort of aspect that I wanted to bring your attention to. So, really speaking, there are 28 entries in Schedule 1 of the form or of the register that is maintained under Section 7. And the change under Section 22 is only limited to those 28 entries and nothing beyond. Now, under 22, the change has to be reported within 90 days, or where any change is desired in such entries, in the interest of the administration of such public trust, then whenever you thought that such change should take place, you should go within 90 days from that decision. And this period of 90 days is condonable. So if you show a valid, satisfactory reason as to why you could not come to court, could not approach the assistant or deputy charity commissioner, then if the assistant or deputy charity commissioner is satisfied of this reason, sufficient cause, then it can entertain even after 90 days. Now, if any change under 22(1)(a) relates to any immovable property, the trustee will be under obligation, along with the change report, to file the memorandum of the immovable property as well. Because under the Section 22(1)(a), the assistant or deputy charity commissioner has to send that memorandum of the immovable property to the sub-registrar's office under Section 89, because sub-registrar thereafter files it in its book F that is maintained under the Registration Act. But that apart, it's not material for anyone to understand. But just as a matter of procedure that is done. Now, under 22.2, for the purpose of verifying the correctness of the entries in the register kept under section 17 or ascertaining whether any change has occurred in any of the particulars recorded in the register, deputy or assistant charity commissioner may hold an inquiry in the prescribed manner. Now, that inquiry, as I have told you, is generally held under Rule 7 of the Bombay Public Trust Act rules. Now, there is a new provision because Bombay Public Trust Act or Maharashtra Public Trust Act underwent a substantial change by way of Amendment Act of 2017, where now, as I told you, this change of proceedings used to be lengthy. And even in the matters where the change used to not be contested, so even in uncontested matters, the change report used to take many years. Therefore, by way of amendment, now the state has introduced a provision whereby what the assistant charity commissioner can do is, assistant charity commissioner, upon filing of the application under section 22, may pass a provisional order. And after passing the provisional order, it may issue the public notice of 15 days inviting objections to such order or such change. Now, naturally, if there are no objections filed within the prescribed period, the order passed will be treated as final. But if there are objections filed, then a proper inquiry has to be undertaken to understand the merits or rather test the veracity of the objections or test the validity of these objections or rather the test to test the to test whether a change has occurred or if at all the change has occurred, whether such change is valid or legal. After final finding or after rendering its finding under section 22, as I told you, it again relates back to section 17 register where the charity assistant charity commissioner after entering its finding will have to enter such finding in the section 17 register. But at the same time, please note that this finding rendered under section 17 is appealable. If you are dissatisfied with the finding given by the assistant charity commissioner, your appeal remedy lies before the charity commissioner. And if the charity commissioner also gives an order with which you are not satisfied, you have to approach the High Court. Based on the outcome of the proceedings, as the case may be, an entry finally will have to be made in the section 17. Under section 3A of section 22, the trust, the charity commissioner, the deputy or the assistant charity commissioner has the power to revoke the trust. But that revocation will take place only in limited on the basis of limited reasons, for the limited reasons. When the assistant or deputy charity commissioner is of the view that the purpose is completely fulfilled and the purpose of the trust has become unlawful and the fulfillment of its purpose becomes impossible by destruction of the properties of the trust. Let's say for whatever may be the reasons. Now, if the assistant or deputy charity commissioner is of the opinion that the trust for these three reasons needs to be revoked or the trust is revocable by the author or by the trustees and it is revoked in accordance with the procedure or in accordance with the clauses of the trust, then the trust can be revoked under section 3A. And also, if the assistant or deputy charity commissioner comes to the finding or is of the opinion that trust is not fulfilling or doing any act of fulfilling its object, then also the assistant or deputy charity commissioner can revoke the trust and accordingly make change under section 17 register. That also is the power which is vested with the assistant or deputy charity commissioner by virtue of section 20. What happens when you revoke the trust? What happens if there are still the properties which are after revocation to be dealt with? Then what the section 22 says is that if there is such property where the trust on account of its object becoming illegal, on account of its purpose having been satisfied, on account of its property being incapable of utilization, then in such cases, if there is a property, if there are any funds, then those funds can be deposited by the assistant under the order of the assistant or deputy charity commissioner in Public Trust Administration Fund created for that purpose under section 57. But generally that doesn't happen because generally trusts are functional and they, if the trust is not functional, then the principle of Cyprus is invoked, whereby the charity commissioner or the charity commissioner takes a decision that if the trust is not has become incapable of functioning, then the funds of that trust can be utilized for the purposes of for the purpose of some other charitable purpose. So generally, this very seldom this provision is really speaking. Moving on, while the inquiry has to take place under Section 22, as I told you, the assistant or deputy charity commissioner also has to understand the provisions of or the instrument of the provisions of the instrument of the trust and give its finding on the interpretation of the deed also. So it is not only a clerical inquiry under section or under Rule 7 of the Bombay Public Trust Act, but it's a wholesome inquiry, or rather it's a judicial inquiry, whether there is a change occurred, or if there is a change, whether such change is valid or legal. So on these two aspects, the assistant or deputy charity commissioner has to undertake a very judicial inquiry and has to render findings accordingly. Therefore, the authority exercising its function under Section 22 is a judicial authority and not an administrative authority at all. And therefore, the orders passed by the assistant or deputy charity commissioner under Section 22 are generally appealable. When the charity commissioner in appeal passes an order which you are agreed by, then you have to go before the single judge and not the division bench, under as per the rule of 636 of the Bombay. Now, for the purposes of Section 18, 19, 22, no civil court can exercise its jurisdiction to decide any issue which is otherwise covered by these sections. And therefore, there is a bar of civil court jurisdiction as encapsulated or as laid down in Section 31. Now, under Section 31 to 34, these are generally the budget provisions or the account or audits provisions. Now, I'll tell you how and in what sense the charity commissioner exercises its function or exercises its jurisdiction or power or control over these functions of the trust. Now, every trust has to file its budget, tentative budget, at the beginning of the year. Apart from that, the assistant or deputy charity commissioner is also empowered to appoint a special auditor or a special purpose as an auditor to audit the accounts of the trust and make a report. And if the report is filed before the assistant or deputy charity commissioner, and if the assistant or deputy charity commissioner thinks that there is any problem or there is any irregularity or there is any loss that can be seen or ascertained on account of negligence of the trustees or for whatever reasons, then they can direct inquiry and they can take appropriate action against the trustees. Therefore, in one sense, it is not an empty duty of every trustee to invest or rather to file its budget or file its audit in accordance with Section 31 to 34, but it's a connected powers are also vested with the assistant or deputy charity commissioner to ensure that there is nothing wrong that is being done by the trust. There is nothing hanky-panky that is going on in the affairs of the trust on the basis of the accounts or on the basis of the annual reports that are filed. Now, that takes us to the investments or other the properties or other the immovable properties and the funds of the trust. Now, immovable properties, there are certain restrictions on trustees from dealing with the immovable properties of the trust. And so also, the liquid properties or rather the liquidity that the trust has, even for investment or utilization of that money, there are restrictions. Now, under the general understanding, when the trust has certain monies,